we've got 15 minutes. We'll make a start and get through the GPA, what it looks like, and what you can expect to see within a fortnight when our first round of GPAs are released to the parents. So what we've got, it's out of four, so it's a scaled score. We expect every student who's working at standard can receive a 3.0. The GPA is based around learning habits. So any student within our college, it doesn't matter what level they come in at, there's an expectation they will at least receive an average of a 2.8 across the GPA. If there's anything less than a 2.8 in particular areas or subjects, there's cause for concern around their behaviours towards their learning. So it's all based on behaviours, and I'll go into what those behaviours are in a second, but the GPA, it started at the senior college. What it means is you don't have to wait for a term report to come out or a semester report. It's done every 6 weeks on a 6 week cycle throughout the year. So it's a great way to keep informed with the learning and the progress. Thanks, Jez. So GPA descriptors, that's on the sheet in front of you, which we'll unpack a little bit further as we go through. But each criteria, we want to see growth over the year and over your student's child's journey here at Wodonga Middle Years College. So twice a year you do get a detailed report, which is against the Victorian curriculum. So you get that at the end of semester one and again at the end of semester two. And that's all set against the state criteria in terms of progression points and where your child should be at. But we use the GPA results, not necessarily reflective of progress towards those standards, but it's more in terms of their effort and attitude in class, and it gives you a really good snapshot overall. So every subject will give your child a score out of four. That gets averaged out and you get a total GPA at the end of it. So the first one that you've got in front, it's based around outcomes in class. So you can take this home and you can start to have a conversation around, we set the benchmark at three, that's the set standard. So that's learning tasks are completed to the expected standard. If students are going above and beyond the expected standard, that's when they can look at moving into a four. And we've got like approaching, partial understanding, or even with help, shows no understanding. Now our aim at Wodonga Middle Years College is to have no one receive a zero. So even with support and with structure, they still don't show progress in that area. So it's really important for us that we give the students opportunities for growth, and we're hoping that we can, the effort and attitude in class will be reflected in that score there. So opportunities for growth as families, we see that you encourage a child to record all unfinished or upcoming work in a diary or on their iPad. That's something that will contribute towards a positive outcome for the GPA. Talk to them nightly about their learning, ask them if they're able to complete everything in the time they had available, and potentially keep a calendar or a set schedule for upcoming tasks. And I'll go through how you can do that after this. The next area is a little bit different to outcomes. What it's looking at is effective learning skills. So the key descriptor for the second section there is productive use of class time indicates work undertaken in class. So the language again is consistent. So you've got above, you've got expected, approaching, occasionally, and then even with help, they still can't complete the task. So utilise the conferences. So an area, we want you to come in at our term one, term two, and term three student-led conferences and meet with your teachers, because this is where most of the conversation is based around. It's not so much the outcome and what's being produced, it's the effort that's going into it. An empty workbook would indicate poor use of class time, taking time to check and discuss. So if there's any work coming home, to look through the books, are there notes in there? Are there summaries in there? Have they gone back over and been highlighting their work? Are they making good use of the class time? So that's productive use of class time. The second effective learning skill that we value is effort and attitude. And we measure that approach. So we look at, is their attitude above the expected behaviour? Is it where it should be? Is it approaching? Do we occasionally see it, or even with help, there's still no effort or no attitude? So always focus on the effort, not the outcome, and that's really important that we don't praise the result or the score that the student gets. It's they understand the effort that they put in to get there. Because that, you know, the research that we've looked into as educators in the school is we very rarely praise the score that a student might get on a maths assessment. It's understanding the process and the work that goes behind it to get that result. So this is a real solid reflection in terms of effort and attitude in class. And again, it doesn't matter if, you know, where you sit within your learning, if you're 12 months behind, 6 months behind, if you're at level, if you're 6 months in front, effort and attitude's an easy measure in terms of how much the, you know, your child's applying himself in class. The third area, so we look at managing personal learning. So what that encompasses is, can they work independently when they're required to? Can they work collaboratively? And it also measures organisational skills. So areas for growth in that is, you know, when you're talking to your child's teacher, it'll help you understand how they're performing in class. We have a really strong focus on organisation. There's an expectation that they take a binder, iPad and pencil case to every class. Now, at the moment, you get to this part of the term, it's easy for kids to just come just with one pen and a book, sometimes just the iPad. So we're really driving organisation here at the moment, and if we get that support from home, it makes our job a lot easier that the kids are prepared for learning. So when they walk in the door, they send the right message that they're ready and they're committed to learning. So managing personal learning, we feel, is a really important one. You discuss with them at the end of each term how you're going with your equipment, what do you need, you know, especially at the end of the semester, like the books can fill up quite quickly. Things start to become a little bit worn and weathered. So if you can just make sure that, you know, your kids are organised, when they get here, they've got their gear, the teachers will manage it from there. And then it's about working with the kids to make sure they bring their right gear to class. And again, supporting your kids, are they getting their work in by the due dates? Visual reminders are great to have up around at home, and, you know, really encompassing open communication with your teachers, you know, through emails. Teachers may send SMSs home stating when homework tasks are due. So if you're just having those conversations at home, we'll go a long way to supporting kids with managing personal learning. The fourth area that we assess against in the GPA is homework and independent practice. So what we will look at for a four, and we say this to the kids, that homework that's always completed. And what we mean by homework, that can be regular revision of the notes that they've taken that day. So there may not be specific homework that's set, but we also look at independent practice. So if they're participating in external activities, it could be, you know, music, language, sports, arts, those areas, we classify that as independent practice that's supporting those specific learning areas in the class. So someone who's participating in independent practice, completing regular revision of Cornell notes, and that's demonstrated at a high level. So they might come home and write some summaries from the classes that they had that day if they didn't get a chance to. They might reread their notes. All of those things will go towards achieving a four within their homework GPA. So again, if you work your way down with a three, so they mostly complete the revision that's required at home. Approaching would be, you know, they're approaching the expected level. With a one, it'd probably that they're not engaging in homework across all of their subjects. It might just be some of them that they're participating in. And then we obviously have a zero if we're not completing any. So important at home that you can try and build some sort of routine or time in for some independent practice. Get them to bring their equipment home. Try and create a study space that's consistent, that might be, you know, free from distractions, so electronic devices if they don't need them. When they're reviewing their notes, there'd be no need to have any sort of other stimulation around them at the time. And, you know, it doesn't have to be an onerous task, it's just to build the study habits that are going to lead them to be successful when they move to the senior college. So it's very hard for kids to transition from year 9 into year 10, and there's that expectation that you will do home study, and they haven't done it for the 3 years, so we want to start to build that expectation here. And that's why it's on the GPA, that's why we value it, it's important. So it'll be reflected in how much they do. We do have a 10-24-7 note revision structure, so something they should do 10 minutes after a lesson, one day after a lesson, and then 7 days after. And that's all about retention and what they can work on. So we're hoping that, you know, the notes that they take that day, they go back and look at them at the same time the previous day, which they may do some of that in class when they're revising their notes, but we want people to, you know, be engaging in this process at home as well. So, you know, because sometimes for some of our practical subjects, they may not do the theory class for a full week later. It's important that they don't, you know, let a full 7 days lapse before they revisit content again, because, you know, in the busy world of a teenager, that can escape them pretty quickly, even just the next day again. So that's the sheet. I'll go to the next one, Jess, because everyone's got that. That's an example of a GPA report. So you've got the subjects there, that's for a year seven student. So they've got their 5 core subjects, English, Maths, Health, PE, Humanities, Science, and their 2 term electives, so that one's Food, Textiles and Visual Arts. You get an attendance in the middle column, so how often they've been in that class. They get a score out of achievement, and then there are our academic behaviours that we're looking at. So it averages out a GPA for each of those subjects. It collates that and then it generates a GPA there. As the year progresses, that bar graph gives you a visual representation on where that student's operating at. So for a 3.5, you know, that student's had a fantastic, I suppose, first 4 GPA cycles. So you can see where the expected standard is in the yellow, and anything that's under the yellow would be cause for concern in terms of you making sure that you come in and speak to those teachers around why your child's not at the expected level. And that's what we're working through at school with the CARE program, is we're setting goals with kids around their GPA. It's not just a number that they take home and don't revisit. It's really important that it means something to the kids and that they base their goals, their short-term goals around that. Some of the things I've covered, so a regular study routine, make it realistic, make it so they can stick to it, establish good quality areas, communicate with teachers about coursework, and encourage organisation. So I won't go any further, but if you've got any questions, looks like the next group's ready to rock and roll, but yeah, okay, no worries. I've probably got a couple of minutes if you'd like to fire any questions.
Just quickly saying, yep. They're great opportunities for them at the bottom of those slides. Is there any chance we can access that information at all? It's not on this sheet.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. I might put them out. Yeah, no worries. Yeah, that's fine. I can put them out through the Facebook page. I can put this PowerPoint on there because there's, you know, visually it can be fairly transparent. Or I could do a flyer up to come home to.
What do they get on our notes? Is that the book that we have to write?
So it's a structured way that we take notes here at the college. It's based on the AVID principles, so we've gone with AVID school-wide as our teaching and learning model, and it just provides, I suppose, this is how a kid would set up their page in their book. So this is what a Cornell note looks like. They should have an essential question, a learning intention and success criteria. They take their notes here, and what they can do when they go home to summarise their notes is you might have a chunk of information there. They can write questions regarding the notes on the left-hand side, or problems, and they would have a space down the bottom to do a summary. On the left-hand side of their book, this is their output page where they might, you know, put their cutouts or their foldables, or they've done some diagrams that represent the learning that happened that day. So that's the space for the notes, that's the space for the output. So most kids would be working in that format across every subject. Yeah, that's a good question. Any other questions? Alright, if anything comes to mind that you can get a chance to, jump back in the library at the end. But from here, you guys are going to head over there and have a